And as of now, it's becoming, like I say, an easy job. Like, every day I'm used to coming in front of 10,000 people. Like, hi, they're all my friends.
We don't have bad games, or we're not expected to have bad games. We got to be consistent. We have to be good every night. We have a challenge every night. You know, something was given to us by the notoriety, by the media, by the fans, that superstardom. And we have to protect it because everybody's coming in trying to get it.
I'm not conceited. I'm just convinced. Harry, listen, I'm so modest, I can admit my own fault. And my only fault is I don't realize how great I really am.
A lot of success, I think, and this is my belief about athletics, that a lot of success in athletics comes down to almost like a psychosis. You know, like there's like at a real high level of anything, there's a certain amount of almost crazy behavior to get to this incredible position, like a Michael Jordan or Muhammad Ali or any like elite high level, Mike Tyson in his prime, and there's a madness.
It is befitting that I leave the game just like I came in, beating a big bad monster who knocks out everybody and no one can whoop him. That's when that little Cassius Clay from Louisville, Kentucky came up and stopped Sonny Liston, the man who annihilated Floyd Patterson twice. He was going to kill me. But he hit harder than George. His reach was longer than George. He's a better boxer than George. And I'm better now than I was when you saw that 22-year-old undeveloped kid running from Sonny Liston. I'm experienced now, professional. Jaw's been broke, been lost, knocked down a couple times. Bad. Been chopping trees. I done something new for this fight. I done wrestled with an alligator. That's right. I have wrestled with an alligator. I done tussled with a whale. I done handcuffed lightning, throw thunder in jail. That's bad. Only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
Bad dude.
Bad. Fast. Fast. All of you chumps are gonna bow when I whoop him. All of you. I know you got him. I know you got him picked, but the man's in trouble. I'm gonna show you how great I am.
See, most people's version of Ali is really distorted because their version of Ali is Ali post the 3-year break.
Yeah.
And he, when he came back and fought Jerry Quarry, he was not the same fighter by any stretch of the imagination as he was in 67. It wasn't just ring rust. I mean, he became old. He didn't do shit.
3 years
he didn't even go to the gym for 3 years. He didn't do anything. Cleveland Big Cat Williams fight is, in my opinion, one of the greatest performances that any boxer ever put on ever. It was a real big, strong guy, a dangerous guy, coming after a genius. The way he did it was just poetry.
When you watch him fight Sonny Liston, there's a book called, I read it, by David Remnick called King of the World about that fight.
Yeah.
And what was amazing about Ali is Ali said, Sonny Liston is the baddest guy on the planet, right? But the one thing he's afraid of is crazy.
Yeah.
So he acted crazy. He would park his car on Sonny Liston's lawn in the middle of the night and start calling him out. He said, come on out and fight me now, Sonny! And Sonny was actually afraid. He said later on, he goes, I'm afraid this guy might bite me. Are you sure this guy doesn't bite? And so Ali knew he could get into his head. He was also like Diaz. I mean, he's a psychological warrior.
Yeah,
get
of course. Head, well, he was the first.
Yeah.
He was the first to figure out. He was a genius.
They had to hold him back. His blood pressure was so high when he was doing the weigh-in. He was trying to get at him and talking to him. The guy, and Sonny listened.
They almost didn't let him
crazy.
Fight. Yeah. The thing about Ali was that 3-year break. And then after that 3-year break, then he fights Jerry Quarry. He fights Joe Frazier and loses. He's not the same guy.
No.
He's just not the same guy. And then he became a guy who was known for not just moving, but taking punishment. He just didn't move the way he used to move.
Right.
If you look at the old movement, his shuffle, his footwork, it's fucking genius.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Muhammad Ali has just refused to be inducted into the United States Armed Forces.
People don't realize what a cultural hero that Muhammad Ali was, because what he had done was stepped up and said,
my conscience won't let me go shoot my brother.
or some darker people, or some poor hungry people in the mud for big powerful America, and shoot them for what? They never called me nigger. How can I shoot them poor people? I'll just take me to jail.
You know, and he's right, and he was 100% right, and everybody knew it, and it made sense. And because of that, they punished him, and they wouldn't let him box for 3 years.
Right.
You know, they took away his livelihood in the prime of his career, like physically.
The most difficult part about fighting is the training, because believe it or not, the easy part about fighting is the fighting.
There was a bunch of guys when I was a big boxing fan in high school, and this was around that time that Tyson sort of rose to prominence, like right when I was getting out of high school. It was like the cover of Sports Illustrated, and he was 19 years old.
Yeah.
Fuck. And he was just fucking smashing people. LL Cool J is hard as hell. Battle anybody, I don't care, you tell. I accept. When Mike Tyson fights would come on, everybody would fucking gather around.
Yeah.
For one brief moment, one brief period of history, he changed that whole sport.
Yeah.
He changed watching boxing. Watching boxing was never watching an execution. Like, look at Mike Tyson's just body. You look at that's like a guy that looks like he's designed to destroy things. Just designed to. Like, when he used to step into the ring, when he was in the prime of his life in the late 80s, he would get into that fucking ring, and it was like, that is the scariest human being that's ever walked the face of the earth. You couldn't imagine doing anything else. That's what he was there for. He's there to smash things. So that was the most interesting thing about Tyson when he was young, is that he moved like a man much smaller than him.
He
you watch like the Mike Tyson Marvis Frazier fight, that is one of the most disturbing boxing matches ever, because Marvis knew what was going to happen. We knew what was going to happen. Tyson knew what was going to happen. The announcers knew what was going to happen. You know, they were all talking about it. This is, you know, a lot of people saying this is a mismatch, and then Tyson just comes raring at him
very quickly.
You make women, men look like drunk ants.
Yeah. But when he won the title, he did that. Remember? Who the fuck did he fight? That guy who was a...
Trevor Burbick.
Larry Holmes was older when he fought him, you know, so I would have loved to have seen a prime Larry Holmes, because Larry Holmes gave him a hard time with the jab in the first round. But in the second round, Tyson just started moving his head more, found his rhythm,
right.
Eventually caught him with a monster punch, dropped him, and, you know, Larry Holmes was a long-time heavyweight champion. Nobody had ever done that to Larry. And when he fought Michael Spinks, that was one of the big fights of Tyson's career. And Michael Spinks was a former light heavyweight champion who had gone up to heavyweight and beaten Larry Holmes by decision. But there was a look in his eyes when they were reading, you know, when the guy was going over the rules and they were looking at each other.
I was ringside when he fought Michael Spinks in Atlantic City. It was scary. It was like up jumped the devil. It's like smoke was coming out of his nostrils.
He took shit to a whole new level. He's a part of the sports history. No one, I think, today can appreciate how dominant he was when he was in his prime.
Yeah.
Tyson threw ungodly things that had never existed in the heavyweight division before. Nobody had ever ripped the body to the head like the way he did, where he would throw that right hook to the body and then that right
and then
uppercut.
Straight, yeah.
And his whole body would torque. And oh,
like,
my God.
Like,
do you know how tough he was, man?
The beating.
The Buster Douglas one, dude. That combination that he blasted Tyson with. And Tyson still tried to put his mouthpiece back in.
Yeah.
That motherfucker was game to the end.
Dude.
Blasted out. And he's just scratching around looking for his mouthpiece to get back in his mouth,
because
he's gonna fuck you up.
Yeah,
he's gonna get up and he's gonna fuck you up.
Yeah.
And then when he failed, people, like, there was like a weight lifted off the world of like a million men.
You like to see the bully knocked down.
Yeah,
and they're never the same.
Sure.
He was never the same after that. He never fought the same. He never had the same confidence.
It's almost impossible to keep up the level of RPMs that he was operating at. You know, when he was at the very top of his game, when he was like challenging for the heavyweight title, and he was training, you know, getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning every time running. Once girls start coming into the picture and money starts coming in the picture.
I wish him all the luck in the world, because that's a true motherfucker right there. We watched that guy come, go again, and he's back. Not many people can bounce that back from that.
I missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot. And missed. I've failed over and over and over again in my life. And that is why I succeed.
He's a fascinating subject to me. I follow him very closely.
Do you?
Yes, very closely. Because I'm obsessed with extreme winners.
Yeah.
Because I think there's a madness to it. And I truly believe that in order to be truly great at something, you have to give in to a certain amount of madness. And how much can you manage that madness? I don't know. But guess what? If you want to be that guy flying through the fucking air with your tongue out in front of the baddest motherfucking basketball players in the world and kicking shit on a level that they've never seen before, Dr. J, suck my dick, stupid. Watch this. I'm going to fly through the air. How about that? How about I'm going to do some shit that nobody's ever done? I'm going to hit some fucking layups that's going to have all you white bitches scratching your head. He was the first guy that would literally fly through the fucking air, slamming in dunks, where you would see it on the highlight reels on like ESPN, you would see it on the news, and people would just be standing there shaking their head going, how the fuck can he do that? He was flying.
Artie Lang used to say, if Michael Jordan had been on the Titanic, it would not have sunk. he would have been fucking like, he would have just plugged every hole.
I'm fascinated by ultra bad motherfuckers, but there's a reality to there's a madness to them. And Michael Jordan is just this ultra bad motherfucker who's obsessed with it. He just has to constantly get new pussy. He has to constantly get the latest Ferrari. He has to constantly be playing golf and winning money and gambling on basketball games and gambling on baseball games and gambling on whatever the fuck he can, man. He's just out there
riding it. I think a lot of athletes.
I believe he's also got a real, real problem with gambling and any sort of games. And he's got it bad, man, with golf. He's got it bad, dude. He loses and he doesn't even pay. He gets mad at people and doesn't pay.
For the public, do you have a gambling problem?
No, I enjoy it. It's a hobby. Soon, whenever I walk away from this game, I think that's the only thing that people are going to say was a bad thing about Michael Jordan. No, I didn't commit a crime, but he gambled.
I really do believe that madness and excellence are just next door neighbors. I really do. I think in order to hit the levels of proficiency that those guys hit, like the true greats, like a guy like Jordan Walker.
Jordan's a good example because he's fucking crazy.
Yeah,
of course. He's one of those guys, like when he did his acceptance speech for the Hall of Fame, he was complaining about people who rejected him.
And, you know, Jerry Krause was right there, and Jerry's not here. Obviously, I don't know who invited him. I didn't, but I hope he understands.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of people that, you know, they never find peace. Their life is always chasing something, chasing, you know, a win, chasing a victory, chasing whatever the fuck it is.
Don't you love that about stand-up, Joe? Like, we can get better until we get fucking conked on the head.
It's true.
But no matter what Jordan does, no matter what nutrition, he can go visit the monks in Nepal, nothing's going to make him Michael Jordan again.
I am here to announce my retirement from the game of basketball.
And I will go sailing no more. But no, it can't be true. I can fly if I wanted to, like a bird in the sky.
One day you might look up and see me playing the game at 50. Never say never, because limits, like fears, are often just an illusion. Thank you very much. Look forward to it.